Right, welcome back from that short break. Now, it is sports this morning on Urban Today, and we're going to take a quick look at what has been making headlines on the local and international scenes. Nicholas is definitely joining us this time around for this quick update. Good morning to Nicholas.
14 days into the month of May, the year is 2019, and it is a Tuesday, Days of Our Lives. yesterday,
I wish you could pause there and we all say it's Days of Our Lives.
You guys have to pick up your own lives, but yesterday we lost two handsome souls. Apparently, they walk into a pool. The manner in which they actually died was quite alarming because, I mean, according to reports, they held hands, walked towards this pool, and then drowned. You don't get that. It's a rare thing, you know? I mean, you walk into a pool.
These are kids.
I would love to think. Yeah, you know, they were playing around the pool. They were unattended, and then somehow they accidentally fall into the pool. That sounds okay, but what doesn't sound okay is we held hands
and decided to walk into the pool.
Yeah,
that's disturbing.
Yeah, I mean, we hold hands with our bays and walk into the lake or the beach.
We
are 45, 50 people.
We're actually trying to make sense of this story.
Yes. But where you're going is not right.
I can imagine what they're going through. As a dad, I wouldn't want to believe such. I mean, it's going to take me years to actually believe and stomach the manner in which my children died, you know. Like they held hands, walked into a pool. It doesn't add up.
I think that as a parent, you need to respect God and nature. You do not try to look for who caused it. Because you will never find out.
I'm not trying to pick a blame. I'm trying to make sense of the report. You know what I mean? Mm. I mean, like I said, from a parent's perspective, I mean, you'd want if you got a phone call, the kids have died or that your child has died. How? Okay, and that how for me again is disturbing. I mean, holding hands, walking towards a pool. But anyway, we can never find out the real truth because we're not behind it anyway.
Just one thing. We are discussing about some of the things to keep out of the reach of children. As a father, what is the one thing that you always keep out of?
Power. Look, those electric devices. You know, you see where you have to. Time and again, you're told to block or barricade those power sources because one thing's clear: they love picking small things, dry cells, hot water, like those percolators. You know, kids live in areas whereby you know they're hazardous things that could actually cause harm. So power sockets, hot water. What else could I think of?
Medicine
as well. You know, keep them out of the kids. Coins, because I've been a victim as well. My son last year actually saw the coin. So
it was a 100 shilling.
Yeah, that's how big it was. But like I said, these are things that you don't see coming, and you're not going to blame anyone because it matters. You leave these people to actually, you know, secure your kids. You can never rule out such incidents. And also housemates, by the way.
You need to keep
housemates away from your kids because 2 years ago, a ruthless human being took out their rage on a little kid, a little boy.
Think
on your own size for crying out loud. And I'm here, she's actually out of jail. But anyway, so many things.
Each other pick up on each other. It'd be a good one.
Imagine what the parent would actually say to human being. Who are you really?
Nobody ever said very much, sir.
But
they have a
so for you, ultimately, keep maids away from
keep maids, man. These days, if you can't get like.
So if you keep maids away and all the other stuff away, who's going to raise your kids?
These days, you have daycare.
You have professional daycare.
Recently, there was a kafuri that came out from South Africa.
Yes.
A woman lashing at this 5-year-old kid. That kind of video, I mean, there was a heavy slap behind it. I was thinking, my goodness.
People are saying, "Tell me, let's go on to football." No, that's of course some sports coming in right here. The Fresh Diary Secondary School games are taking headline, and of course, Chumuli SS is coming up to do very impressive work done, of course, as far as this league is concerned. Could you give me some of the highlights right there?
Well, the Fresh Diary Secondary School games ended on Saturday. Unfortunately, yesterday we weren't here to give you the updates, but as far as the 7th edition was concerned, down in Eastern Uganda, Mbale, it was Chibuli SS that excelled. They reached the finals in the boys' basketball, lost out to Budo SS, and also claiming gold in badminton. Now, the major highlight was Karimba Muslim right there, beating up on St. Noah, the maiden finalist. Of course, a wild celebration, sending St. Noah to what was a hard-fought victory, doing it the hard way, winning their 9th title in the girls' football. In, of course, girls' basketball, St. Noah fell out to St. Mary's Chitendo, who came out to reclaim their title, winning gold, while St. Noah had to settle for silver, and Budo SS, who lost out in the semifinals, are settling for bronze. Boys basketball, like I hinted on earlier on, it was Budo SS that came out to, surprise Djibouti SS, the defending champions, to lift their first title since 2016. As for badminton, it was in Mbogo High that claimed gold, after beating up on Hana High School, who settled for silver, and for Djibouti SS settling for bronze. Boys badminton, it was Djibouti SS winning gold, Kakungu Memorial and Kiwana High School securing silver and bronze respectively. As for boys hockey, it was Smack out to beat up on Intare in the finals to win gold, while Intare won silver, and Garempe Muslim winning bronze. Girls hockey, Kakungu Memorial outshined the side in Bweranyanji Girls in what was a one-sided affair, while St. Mary's Tutende grabbing a bronze. Lawn tennis, Djibouti SS, Kololo SS, and Old Kampala coming out to secure gold, silver, and bronze respectively. As for lawn tennis girls, Djibouti SS also came out on top yet again, thanks to a one youngster in Winnie Birunji, the teenager coming out to do what she was expected to do. Mary Hill in second, winning silver, and Namugunga girls in third place. Tennis boys, it was of course in Bogo College with gold, Seta Green with silver, and St. Michael with the bronze. And table tennis girls, finally, it was in Bogo Mixed and St. Michael with the silver, and in Bogo College with the bronze. That is how the seventh edition of the Fresh Diary secondary school ball games came to end. Last year they were in Nyakasura for Potro. This year they were in Imbali, Eastern Uganda. Next year we're to see who will be having the bid as far as the ball games were concerned. But the beauty about the ball games is that we had a much bigger number, and we also had a sponsor involved. And this should be a lesson for all the other private companies who tend to selfishly hold back their monies and find no usage of that money. But I want to believe Fresh Diary, of course, came out with the good intentions, and I do believe that in the next edition they will very much be part of this outing.
Well done to, of course, Fresh Diary for coming up to sponsor this kind of tournament. It's always great to provide a platform for the young generation, put out their talent as far as sports is concerned. Let us cross over to some another interesting league or tournament that has been going on. Copa Coca-Cola.
The Copa Coca-Cola has ended week number 2, and also the fact that 16 schools have marched into the round of 16. And yesterday, a number of games were played across the Jinja region, whereby it was Kitara Motor School that lost out to Kawempe Royal 4-2, with Kawempe Royal securing their second win of their campaign. Masaka SS and Nile High did end up in a goalless draw, just like Riakasinga and also Kasenyi Secondary School. Archbishop Flynn put 3 past Town College, Tororo Town College, while Alliance High School fell out to Murusa Academy. Djibouti SS claimed the day. They beat up on Akiwa Comprehensive Secondary School 2-1. Wild Rock High School were involved in a 6-3 with Busoga College Mwiri. Restored a Leadership Academy, 4-1 winners over secondary school, while Jipra Progressive, having put 3 past Captura Standard Academy, with Jipra reaching the round of 16. St. Mary's College, Roshoroza, are falling out narrowly to High Standard Katera, while Nabdongo also losing out to Kakungu Memorial 2-1. Jinja, a senior secondary school, hammering the side in Beam SS 10-0, while St. Paul's SS also falling out to Lugazi Homeland 2-0. Now, the results that also came out from the round of 16, the following did reach the knockout stage. We do have Group A, Jipra and St. Kagwa. Group B, Jinja SS and Bulo Pirates. Group C, Royal Giants and St. John's Mukono. Group D, Standard High Schools, Zana and Kisosi Seed. Group E has St. Mary's Chitenda, the all-time cup winners, and Nakasaki International College. Group F has St. Henry's College, Chitovu and St. Julian. Group G did have Masaka SS and Kwempe Royal College. And finally, Group H had the cup holders in Djibouti S, in Budo SS and Djibouti SS. I'm looking forward to the round of 16, because then it brings more excitement, more entertainment, and successfully completing week one, whereby 120 goals have been registered going into the round of 16.
Italy did not qualify for the round of 16.
No, they did not. Apparently,
high school did not qualify.
Definitely, they also missed out. That is how competitive it has been in the Copa Coca-Cola, because then even the bigger sides have found difficulty.
I think they didn't qualify because it was competitive then in our time, and now it's
was more competitive back then.
Yeah, back then.
I think it comes back
to
the
supporting now.
For us, the referee refuses to give us the
penalty. So now you're saying that those two didn't qualify because they weren't just good enough, or because the competition is not as good as back then?
It's not as good as back then.
Maybe the schools dropped
us. If Kitele can be held by Eka One Abim, then what makes you think that it's not competitive?
It might be competitive, but not as good as it was back then. Because Chitende would give you like 10. There's a team in Rwanda that gave the other 10 goals to nil.
Okay, that is a story. It's a story that says that the other side was better than the other side. You get? Because if it's 10-1, then...
For us, back in the days, you score us more than 2 goals.
It could have been a red card.
The match ends. Motocross round 4, of course, down in Garuga. We did have Osbert here who gave us an interesting highlighter. But we need to get into the technical bits here and there. Would you please take us through?
Well, the fourth round of the National Motocross, of course, came out on Sunday in Garuga, the Victoria Racetrack, where team captain Maxime Vampy again coming out to maintain his lead in the MX1 category, and with the absence of Asaf Natan and also Fatou Tchigundou still struggling for form, yet to match Maxime Vampy. But the biggest highlight was those the Peewees, both the senior and the junior. They phoned it quite hard to actually come through on that racetrack. It was a very wet racetrack in Garuga, but eventually the sun came out at about 2 p.m. And the beauty about it is because we did have man there right there in Mubiru coming to support his own very youngster, and also other parents as well turning up. The Olan brothers failed to turn up because they were engaged in a race down in the USA. A couple of returnees in there, including Ali Omar, who gave Maxime Vampy quite a challenge in the 125 that was combined with the MX1, where Maxime Vampy had the finest of winning all three heats in the race, or in the class of MX1. When you look elsewhere, the 125, Ali Omar marking his return, followed by Fortune Sentamu, who also gave Maxime Vampy quite a run for his money in the third and final heat, because then the MX125 was combined with the MX1, was Zero Mar in third place. When you look at the MX2, it was a one-sided outing. Ismail Muchibi coming out on top, followed by Rodrigo Oliveira and Mike Ontario, as well as the MX Vets, where we only had two riders in Peter Pelzer and Paul Mutesasa. When you look at the younger drivers, or the younger riders, Liam Intale and Ashraf Mbabazi doing quite well in the MX Peewee, while in the MX 50, it was William Blake calling the shot. 65cc, it was the usual suspect in Gift Sebuguzi, who was, of course, was given a very huge task thanks to Isabella Blake's continuity as far as the MX4 was concerned. Suga Crater in third place, and of course for the 85 we had Walid Omar, Killingwe Kessa finishing in first and second place. Unfortunately for Jeremiah Mawanda, he came out to finish outside the podium after he succumbed to an injury, putting down to, of course, a DNF in the third and final heat of the 85cc category.
I must say this is the first of its own interesting kind of moto game where I've seen, you know, toddlers are participating. And what does that mean for the future of the game?
Well, the toddlers or the young riders, these are the future of the sport. Time and again, we see them out there and we ask ourselves, are they really supposed to be out there? Because this sport is quite a dangerous sport. If that kid was to land awkwardly, they could probably break a leg or an arm. But because they have the support that they require, the fans, the parents that urge them time and again, and the fact that they love the game as well, because then it's one thing to be forced by your parent, it's just another thing to be wanting the sport, because it's the only way to better yourself by having a passion for it. So the kids are the future of the sport, and I want to believe that in the long run, if they continue having the support from the sporting governing body FIM, from the parents and the fans as well, because again, they're out there to entertain the fans, you know.